Good morning, Calvary. Welcome to the place where the body of Christ gathers to worship Jesus Christ. Thank you for being here today, joining us either live and in person or out there somewhere in internet land watching our live stream. Thank you for being here. Would you stand in this place as we come before the presence of Almighty God? With these words, I'm going to read a few background verses first. God is revealing to King David all the ways in which he provides for him. May our sons in their youth be like plants full grown, our daughters like corner pillars cut for the structure of the palace. May our granaries be full, providing all kinds of produce. May our sheep bring forth thousands and ten thousands in our fields. May our cattle be heavy with young, suffering no mishap or failure in bearing. May there be no cry or distress in our streets. Now, blessed are the people to whom such blessings fall. Blessed are the people whose God is the Lord. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Let's set that up together. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, O creatures.
Streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name.
take a few minutes to tell just someone beside you the blessing that God has given you. Come on. Turn around and just say, hey, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name, Father. Oh, blessed be your name, Jesus. We praise you with all we are. Have your way in this place, for it is for you and you alone. Oh, let's lift our voices, church.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all.
One voice, one heart.
Jesus paid it all to him I owe.
Sing it loud.
Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white.
Oh, we believe. Lord, now.
Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spot.
Jesus paid it all.
Jesus paid it all to him I owe.
Yeah.
Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
He washed away all my sin and all my sin.
My soul to sing, my lips shall still remain.
Oh, all together we sing it. Father, hear your praise this morning.
Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left the crimson stain. He washed it white.
Oh, sin had left a crimson stain.
Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
You believe, church?
He washed it white.
He washed as white as snow.
He washed it white as snow.
Yeah. Oh, we praise you in this place, Father. We lift it up.
Oh, praise the world. Life up from the dead.
got it. Jesus paid it all. Jesus paid it all.
Sin had left a crimson stain, but he washed it white as snow.
Amen. Yeah.
Jesus, all the attention is drawn to you this morning, exalted high at the throne of God, where God the Father has given you a name, Jesus, that is above every name, that the name of Jesus, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord. And he is worthy of all our praise because he paid it all. He didn't pay the sum of it, the part of it. He didn't overlook some sin. He didn't overlook some people whose sin was just too much of a price to pay.
That's right.
He looked at every one of us, and he paid it all. The total price before a just and holy God, the price of death, so that we could have eternal life. Jesus, we exalt you and thank you for life. Amen. Please be seated. Before we dive into today's subject from God's Word concerning treasures, just a couple of reminders while the parents are taking their kids to their kids' time. You all should have received one of these. If you didn't, make sure you see an usher on the way out and get one. This is your lifeline to what's going on at Calvary, the connector. And I just want to highlight a couple of things from this. The CORES class that I teach on the five basic fundamental principles upon which this local body of believers is grounded and founded from the book of Acts, the five principles called CORES. That class has been meeting on Wednesday night during our Awana time, since Awana is now complete for the year. That CORES class will start meeting next Sunday morning at 8:45 in my office. If you're new to Calvary and you want to know what Calvary stands for, what we believe, what our history is, where we're going, this would be the class for you to come to next Sunday morning at 8:45. Also, this week on Saturday afternoon is the full-length feature movie War Room showing here in this auditorium, free of charge, sponsored by Family Christian Stores, and we would love to have you come. Even if you've seen it before, it would be a great part of our ongoing emphasis on prayer here at Calvary. And then one final thing, a word of praise. I don't know, you probably already saw this. Note from Apple, our partner in ministry with Caring for Crisis Pregnancies. Dear Congregation of Calvary, thank you for participating back in January in the Baby Bottle Boomerang fundraiser. We raised $2,449.96 toward the support of that ministry. That's $760 more than last year. Thank you for your generosity. And speaking of generosity, that's what today's theme is in our study of treasures, discovering the eternal purpose. And today's theme is add to the storehouse. Now, I need to preface what I'm about to teach with a reminder of what has already been taught in the first two sessions of our study of treasures. And there is a specific reason I am wearing this tie today. It is because in the context of everything we're going to teach from Scripture today about the proper use of our financial treasures, this is the reason we do it. Because Jesus has already paid it all. Everything that we have, everything that we possess, if I can even use that word, because that's not a biblical word, because we don't possess anything, we don't own anything. We have all been granted certain things by God for His glory and His purpose, and we use them to exalt His name, not our own name, and not to fulfill our ends and our means and our purposes, but to fulfill His. And it's all because we have a proper understanding of what grace is. That we did not receive our salvation because of anything we did. We did not earn it. It was a gift of God through faith, which in itself is still even a gift of God, for none of us is capable of faith. That has to be given to us by God as well. Everything we are, everything we have, is God's. And when we choose to use what He has given us for our own purposes, we stand in contradiction to what He has declared to be the proper use of His resources. So, having said that, let's begin. Pastor Ken Shigematsu, who originally was from Japan, now lives in British Columbia, shares the following story. His wife, Saiko, no, S-A-I-K-O, it's probably Seiko, okay? Did that on purpose, sorry. My wife Seiko, her family loves animals. And in their home in Osaka, Japan, they regularly take abandoned cats or dogs, even abandoned wild animals, into their home. At one point, they took in a wild chipmunk. This chipmunk had been found abandoned by its family because it was the runt of the pack. And they took it to the veterinarian. I know, you don't take chipmunks to the veterinarian. You feed them to the fox. The run of the pack, and the veterinarian had said it would probably only survive for a few days. So she took the chipmunk home and named him Forte. Not after the Bears football player, but after the musical term, which means to grow stronger. He not only survived, but he began to thrive. When Seiko came back to her apartment in the evenings after work, Forte would wake up and run excitedly around her apartment doing figure eights all over the place. Or if she was working on her computer at home, he would scamper up and down the keyboard pressing on random characters. But she noticed something interesting. The walnuts that she would give him as food became his prized possession, and he would take them and store them in the place where he slept. Natural instinct to store your food, to store your resources. But as Seiko and the chipmunk gained a closer and deeper relationship, she noticed something one night when she got ready to go to bed, and she moved her pillow to fluff it, and Forte had begun taking half of the walnuts from his storehouse and putting them under her pillow. Out of gratitude, he wanted to share with her what he had so freely been given. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 8, please. 2 Corinthians 8, would you stand as I read the first 7 verses? We want you to know, brothers, about the grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia. For in a severe test of affliction, their abundance of joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For they gave according to their means, as I can testify, and beyond their means, of their own free will. begging us earnestly for the favor of taking part in the relief of the saints. And this, not as we expected, but they gave themselves first to the Lord, and then by the will of God to us. Accordingly, we urged Titus that as he had started, so he should complete among you this act of grace. But as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for you, see that you excel in this act of grace also. Please be seated. Which act of grace is he talking about? The act of generosity. Let's define generosity. As I break down the Greek word, I come to this conclusion. Generosity is a sincere, single-minded passion resulting in abundant and profuse giving with no ulterior motives or self-seeking intentions. Let me break that down a little further for you. The act of taking a check and putting it into an offering plate is not generosity. That is an action that is a result of generosity. Generosity in the Greek language is an attitude that displays, that is an attitude of a sincere, single-minded passion. A sincere, single-minded passion about what? About the grace of God. You see, we carry around with us in these jars of clay, this treasure of the life of Jesus Christ. And it is our passion for Him, our passion for knowing Him, our passion for loving Him, our passion for serving Him, our passion for continually and consistently falling on our faces in humble worship that He, from beyond and before the foundations of the world, reached down and chose us to be His children and then paid the entire purchase price to make that happen. That passion that drives us as the one true passion of life will manifest itself then in the activities of giving, because that is the natural response of a heart that is captured by the generosity of the Savior who gave it all for us. Generosity is a sincere, single-minded passion that results in abundant and profuse giving with no ulterior motives and no self-seeking intentions. Let's break it down from 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and chapter 9. And let's break this down and look at the 10 principles of generosity. They are in your Calvary Connector, and we're not going to spend a lot of time with them because at the end of this message, you're going to have an opportunity. You're going to have three opportunities to let the attitude of generosity display itself in your lives. The principles of generosity, there are 10 of them that I find in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and chapter 9. Number one, in verses 1 through 4, we see that Paul is telling and commending he's telling the people at Corinth about the churches in Macedonia. If you want to know specifically what church it is, it's the church at Philippi. If you go to the book of Philippians, you will discover that Paul commends them for their gifts. They were the only church that supported him, and they were the church that in their generous spirit of love and joy for the Lord, no matter what, were going to give to help the needs of the saints in Jerusalem, and that's what Paul is writing to the Corinthians about, participating in that giving opportunity. Generosity gushes from a sincere heart that is singularly focused on the only true treasure. In verses 1 through 4 of 2 Corinthians 8, Paul says, not only did they give according to their means, But then even in the midst of their severe poverty, they overflowed in a wealth of generosity that went beyond their means. We're going to come back to why they did that a little bit later. Because most of us are stuck in the philosophy of financial management that says, I'll give what I have left after I've met all of my own needs. I'll give what I have left after I have accomplished my purposes. I'll give what I have a little bit extra. I'll give according to my means. But Paul says, generosity, the true heart that is focused on the Lord, because he says in this passage, they didn't do it the way the average person does giving. They first gave themselves to the Lord. And what he means by that is they gave not only their verbal assent that, yes, Lord, you're my Lord and my Savior, but everything about my life is yours. You can have it all. It's all yours anyway. I'm just the manager of it for a short time here on this earth. I'm just the one who that you have chosen to prove himself or herself faithful, faithful to take care of your resources so that your kingdom and your glory are exalted above all else. And I would dare say that many of us don't have generosity gushing from our heart, because our heart may not be all that sincere and singularly focused on the kingdom of God alone, but on our own little kingdoms and what we feel we need. Because even out of their poverty, even when they weren't able to give, even when, as the widow stood before the offering plate in the temple, took out her last two pennies and gave them, and Jesus commended her. What are we doing to take all the extra and use it for self? Generosity gushes from a sincere heart that is singularly focused on the only true treasure. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 9:15, in the same context of this whole giving passage, he says, thanks be to God for his inexpressible, indescribable gift. Thanks be to God. Number two, verse 5, the first part of verse 5 in chapter 8. Generosity requires the giving of self to God first. Not as we expected, Paul says, but they gave themselves first to the Lord. They gave their lives, they gave their hearts, they gave their resources, they gave their time, they gave their energy, they gave everything. When there was a dull moment in life, when there was a point in the budget where it looks like, wow, we're building a cushion here. Wow, it looks like we're going to be able to achieve this goal of buying this or getting that or accomplishing that or taking that trip or spending whatever we want to make life enjoyable for us today, because we all deserve happiness, right? And let's make life just fun. Have you given everything to God's purpose first? To the Lord's purpose first, of accomplishing his kingdom work. Generosity requires the giving of ourselves to God first. Number three, in the second half of that verse of chapter 8, verse 5, it says, they gave themselves first to the Lord, and then by the will of God to us. In other words, it is the will of God to be generous to others before we consider ourselves. They gave themselves to God, and then the result of being in right relationship with God, with the singular, single-minded, sincere focus on who Jesus Christ is, the exalted Lord of our lives, the first and natural response of that is, what can I do for somebody else? Instead of, okay, now what can I do for me? They gave themselves to the Lord first, and then they gave everything to others. It is the will of God, Paul says. They gave themselves first to the Lord, and then by the will of God to us. if you were asked today, and you're going to be, to not only take an offering for the normal expenditures of this church to support its general fund and its ongoing plan to retire the debt. And you'll see a note about that in your connector of the decisions the leadership of the church has made about paying off the debt with the extra giving that comes in, that we're using that not to enhance what we already have, but we're using it to pay off the debt toward the future kingdom growth that the Lord has here for us by His grace, that we have the same opportunity in our management of our resources. We consider others. We consider how to use the extra, not to satisfy some desire that we have. Now, there's a balance here. There's a balance, because the scriptures don't teach that it's a sin to be wealthy. Praise God for that. It does not teach that. It does teach, however, that you don't have any of that wealth as your own. None of it is yours. You are the steward of it on behalf of the one who blessed you with it. And therefore, his will supersedes your desires of how to manage it. Number 4, verse 7. As you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for you, see that you excel in this act of grace also. Generosity is not obedience to a command, it is a loving response to God's grace. Generosity is not obedience to a command. Do not give under compulsion. Do not give because you think, well, this is the way I'm going to get more, or this is the way I'm going to earn my way into the favor of God, or that this is the way I'm going to whatever it might be. Remember, sincere, single-minded passion that has no ulterior motives or self-serving intentions. It is not done to receive anything. It is done as a response to already having received everything. Generosity is not obedience to a command. Paul says it in 2 Corinthians 8, 8 to 9. He says, I say this not as a command, but to prove by the earnestness of others that your love also is genuine, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 9, 5 says, so that it may be ready, in other words, the offering, as a willing gift, not as an exaction. A willing gift. Generosity is always cheerful and willing. This is to be true of every human being. And it is true. I'm going to say this only once because I realize it will take you time to recover from the hurt of it. This is true of every one of us. How we spend the money we have will always reveal what we value and love. We show what we treasure with our wallets. Theologian Heike Obermann tells the following story about the radical generosity of a poor rural church in China. A few years ago, he was with a group in Nanjing, China. And on Sunday, we visited various churches in the city, and an older Chinese woman, now living in Los Angeles, chose to visit a church across the river from Nanjing, a poor church composed only of farmers. 900 farmers present that day for the worship service, and they wanted to hear a word from their Chinese sister who lived in America. So Mrs. Chang brought greetings from her church in Los Angeles. She told how the Lord had added many to their church and how they were currently building a large new addition. Then after a word of blessing for this church, she took her seat. At the close of the worship service, Mrs. Chang was called back up to the front by the pastor. The pastor said her words had thrilled the hearts of the people in the church that day, and they wanted to give her the total morning offering from that Sunday's worship service to take back to Los Angeles to help pay for the addition to the building. The total offering of 900 people that day $140. When their overflowing joy welled up in generosity, they gave beyond their ability. How we spend the money we have always reveals what we value and love. Number five, generosity follows the example of Jesus Christ and is sacrificial in nature. 2 Corinthians 8:9, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you might by his poverty become rich." I said we were going to come back to why this church in Corinth, or rather in Macedonia, was able to go even in their beyond their normal means and dig deep into their pockets of poverty and give even more and above. It's because they understood that what they had been given was sacrificial. Therefore, what they gave was sacrificial. Warren Buffett, you know who that is, one of the wealthiest men in all the world, gave a $26 billion gift to the Gates Foundation. Imagine that, being able to give $26 billion away. And this is what he said about the gift, quote, "My gift has not changed my lifestyle one bit. I still do all the things I love to do. But what about the person who gives a gift that requires they won't be able to do what they want to do? They are the true givers, the true heroes of generosity." Unsaved man who understands that generosity will result in a sacrificial spirit. Number six, generosity reflects the just nature of God. Generosity reflects the just nature of God. Look at verses 13 through 15 of chapter 8. "I do not mean that others should be eased and you burdened, but that as a matter of fairness, your abundance at the present time should supply their need, so that their abundance may supply your need, that there may be fairness. As it is written, whoever gathered much had nothing left over, and whoever gathered little had no lack." Please do not take this verse out of context and declare that the Bible all of a sudden teaches socialism. It does not. But it does teach social equity within the body of Christ. I'm thankful that the rest of the New Testament commends those who are rich. Paul says so in his letter to Timothy, commend those that are rich, but challenge them to use their riches to bring equality to the body of Christ. Because generosity will manifest itself in the just, the fair, the equitable nature of God, who treats us all evenly and equally. Now, it doesn't mean you have to go sell your house so that everybody can have the same kind of house. No, out of your abundance, your house is being done. You have your house because it's for the glory of God, and anybody can come over at any time, no matter how well it's been cleaned and what the bathroom looks like, and they're welcome to come anytime if they have a spiritual need, because ultimately everything you own is to be used for the glory of God, right? And how many of you ladies just fainted? I know, that's a tough one. That's a tough one. Your cars, your boats, your campers, everything that you own, are they truly God so that anybody can ask you for it at any time and you will let them use it to whatever their heart's content so that they can enjoy the pleasures that you're able to pay for? Or are you fussy and careful with it? Not that you shouldn't be careful, but we must not be stingy, because generosity reflects the just nature of God. Number seven, the level of generosity determines the level of blessing. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6. The point is this, as Paul goes on and talks about all the ways that the other churches have given and how he's challenging the Corinthians to join them in this great opportunity to experience a generous heart. He says, the point is this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. The level of generosity will determine the level of blessing, but the level of blessing can never be the motive for the level of giving. We already established that, right? It's a sincere, single-minded passion that will manifest itself in prosperous giving with no ulterior motives or self-serving intentions. The return that you get from God is God's additional blessing to you because that's His heart of grace. It's not because we earned it by doing the giving. Number 8, generosity is our intentional response to the joy of our salvation. Chapter 9, verse 7, each one must give as he has made up his mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Generosity is our intentional response to the joy of our salvation. How can we not want to take half of our walnuts and put them under the pillow of the one who gives us life? How can we dare to limit ourselves to some kind of an obedient Old Testament command that says, give your tenth and then you're done and you've met your obligation? How can we dare claim ownership of 90% when all is God's? It is the natural response, the intentional response to the joy of our salvation. My wife and I have discovered this joy over the years of giving, of supporting missionaries with the abundance, of giving beyond the normal requirements of giving to the local church, of giving to other ministries as their needs come up, and of giving to people when they have needs individually, whether I get a tax break for it or not. The joy of generosity is the product of truly understanding the joy of your salvation. And I believe that one of, if not the greatest detriment to the joy of generosity is the attitude of deserving it. Entitlement. But I'm entitled to have a nicer car. I'm entitled to have a nice place to live. I'm entitled to have this, or I'm entitled to have that. I'm entitled. I work hard to get all of that. No, you work hard because God gave you the strength to work hard so that you could raise up the resources necessary to accomplish His purpose, because the joy of your salvation that has nothing to do with your works so overwhelms you with His grace that you can't wait to give back to Him. The joy of generosity is the product of the joy of your salvation. Number 9, generosity is the demonstration of trust in God's provision. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. I dare say that our economically based philosophy of life must, if we're honest with ourselves, retranslate that verse as such. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, but I know He needs my help to provide, so that He'll give me part of my sufficiency and part of my all the things I need, and part of what is necessary for me to have an enjoyable life, but I certainly have to take responsibility for providing the rest. Really? You want to take up that debate with the Father who sent his Son to pay it all? Or does generosity demonstrate that we truly trust God's provision? And then number 10, generosity produces thankfulness and glory to God in the lives of those to whom we give. You probably thought that was going to say, well, generosity then will produce thankfulness and glory to God in my life. But notice, the radical concept of the kingdom of God is that it's always about others. That's radical. It's not about me. The things I have are not given to me so that it's about me. The resources I have available to me, the time I have available to me to give to the church, to serve the body of Christ, the energy that I have, the wisdom that we have, the resources we have, none of them are given to me for me. They're given to me so that thankfulness and glory to God will be multiplied in the lives of those to whom we give. Look at chapter 9, verses 11 and 13. You will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. Because the church was generous, Paul was able to be thankful to God. And they, the people to whom they give, will glorify God because of your submission that comes from your confession of the gospel of Christ and the generosity of your contribution for them and for all others. The gospel of Jesus Christ is glorified when the generosity of those who have been impacted by the gospel takes over their lives. The gospel is magnified. So in closing, read this statement. When we acknowledge the source of all treasure and by His grace solely pursue His supply of treasure, we will, with cheerfulness, generously add to His storehouse with the treasures He has supplied. I hope I wrote that in the notes on your page. I think I did not. I'm going to give you a moment to write that down as I refer to just those final 10 things from the great preacher John Ortberg on the financial 10 commandments. You can take those home. We weren't going to deal with those this morning. They're just a bonus for you to look at. But would you write that statement down? When we acknowledge the source of all treasure, and by His grace, we solely pursue His supply of treasure, we will, with cheerfulness, generously add to His storehouse with the treasures He has supplied. Leave that up there, Rebecca, while I tell this final story. Christian leader Gordon MacDonald shared the following story. James Allen, you can bring your team up. Thanks. Christian leader Gordon MacDonald shared the following story about how God transformed him from giving as merely an institutional obligation to a cheerful giver. The process began when Gordon's wife Gail and he made a missions trip to West Africa. And on the first Sunday of their visit, they joined a large crowd of desperately poor Christians for worship. And as they neared the church, they noticed that almost every person was carrying something. Some were hoisting cages of noisy chickens. Others carried baskets of yams. Others had bags of eggs or bowls of pasta. "Why are they bringing all that stuff to church?" he asked one of the hosts. "Watch." Almost everybody in that African congregation brought something. And soon after worship began, the moment came when everyone stood as the songs were being sung and they knew when to do it. By what song was being sung about the blessings of God, the people stood and began moving forward. Not pushing and shoving, they just began to move forward, carrying their chickens and their eggs and their food supplies and their sweet potatoes and placing them at the front of the church. Gordon MacDonald said, I was captivated. I'd never seen a joyful offering before. Obviously, my keep my money under the radar policy would not have worked in that West African church. Those African believers, although they never knew it, had moved Pastor MacDonald. He began to understand that giving, whether yams or dollars, was not an option for Christ followers. Rather, it was an indication of the direction and the tenor of one's whole life. Let's pray. Our Father, in the closing minutes of this service, we are going to have the opportunity to reflect on what you have taught us today and then to put it into practice. The needs of people are great. The potential for growth of this ministry are great. The resources you've provided are greater. Where people move from selfishness to sacrifice, the treasures of heaven will pour out on us. As Malachi promised, why are you stealing from me? It's mine. Bring to the storehouse your gifts, your tithes, and your offerings, so that I may pour out a blessing on you so great you will not be able to contain it. Not because we want something more from you, but because we understand your grace that has already paid it all. So our prayer today, Lord, is to take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. That we may, as Paul challenged the Corinthians to do, give ourselves first to you, and the response with joy will be to give ourselves to others. Amen. Please stand.
be seated. Selah. A time to think about what we've just heard. A time to ask the Lord, what did you have for me during this message? Take a few moments of silence right now. Pray to him. Ask him that message. What does he want you to apply to your life? Go ahead. Lord, thank you for the power of your word to touch our hearts, to change our hearts, to direct our hearts, even in ways that are very difficult. Lord, thank you that you graciously take us by the hand to lead us a step at a time. This is an area that's always been a very difficult one for me. I grew up in a family that talked a lot about money, but it was always the scarcity of money. And so as a child, I was very anxious about tomorrow. I worried a lot about where the money was going to come from to pay for this or that. I think as a result, I put my heart in a box to make sure that I would choose security, that I would choose to make sure I had enough, lest something terrible would happen. And as a result, my view of God was so small. Whenever I had an opportunity to give, I would always default back to, no, I just have to be sure that I'm safe. And it wasn't until a time in college when I really wrestled with my faith and began to see the incredible surrender of Christ, the grace of God in God becoming flesh and dying for me on the cross, that box began to crack open. And I started to take little steps of giving, even though I was afraid. And so, right now, as you think about what we've been challenged with this morning, this whole concept of generosity, I think that's the question. Lord, what's the next step for me? And whenever I'm afraid, and the Lord tends to pull on my heart about an opportunity to give, I've learned to just pause and to gaze at Jesus dying on the cross and ask myself, is that the kind of God that I can trust? Is that the kind of God that's will take care of me. And as my heart relaxes and I say yes, yes, I begin to feel more and more freedom to give, to respond to the prompting of the Holy Spirit. So this morning, we're going to take the offering. The ushers can come forward. And this may be a time that you just give as you usually do, and as you wrestle and think about some of this stuff. But this morning might even be a time where you take a step of faith and you decide to give a little more generously than you have in the past. I think many of you know that the youth group is raising several thousands of dollars to be able to sponsor a bus for the youth group to go on their trip this summer. You see in the bulletin, as Pastor mentioned, that everything that's given over our needs, our regular budget here, is going to be going for paying down the debt of this building so that our crunch needs for educational space can be met as we build phase two. And maybe you're not prepared to give today, but maybe even in the next weeks that you would be led to give a special love gift towards paying off the mortgage and speeding us on the way to that next phase. So let's pray together. Father, thank you. Thank you that we never have to fear, Lord. You are faithful. You've proven it to us again and again. And now again this morning, we want to respond from a heart of thankfulness, of generosity, of joy, to give to you, to your kingdom, to your ministry, and know, Lord, that you are going to take care of us as we become more and more generous. In Jesus' name, amen.
Snowbird Wilderness Outfitters is a gospel-centered discipleship ministry that focuses on partnering with local churches to equip and train students in the areas of personal holiness, finding their identity in Christ as they grow and are built up as disciples, as we prepare to present them mature in Christ, that they gain a passion for the Great Commission and a desire to spend their lives reaching the nations with the gospel. One of the things Snowbird is passionate about is providing student pastors with resources. And so we have a large staff of solid teachers who are trained and equipped. And we teach beyond the main sessions, and those main sessions where we primarily handle the preaching of the Word of God expositionally. We follow that with breakout sessions where we cover areas of doctrine, apologetics, cultural and relational issues, the things that students are going to be able to immediately put to practice in order to be most effective as they pursue Christ and then make an impact for the gospel in their own world. Everything works together. The worship through song, the way that ties into the exposition and handling of the Word of God. When we do use drama, we want that to be in support of the preaching and teaching of the Word of God. Recreation? Our recreation speaks for itself.
Yeah, that's that is where our students are going to be going, along with some of us adults. We, you know, it's going to be hard for us to go too. But as you can, Snowbird, what they're focused on is tethering these students to the gospel and saying, not only are you going to be tethered to the gospel, but we want to present you, as Brody said, mature before Christ. And these students have said, hey, I can give up a week of my summer. I certainly want to go. I want to deepen in my relationship with Jesus Christ. And beyond that, I want the gospel to be known in the community that I'm in. So that way, when I come back, I'm better equipped. What Snowbird does isn't just a big and emotional high, and they come home and they go, yes, I love Jesus. And then 2 weeks later, well, you know, that was fun at camp. They give them tools. They equip them to present the gospel to the community around them. And as you can see, they also have a little bit of fun. But these students all up here and many more, we have a total of 39 of us that are going to be going to Snowbird. We have 39 that are going to be going, and each one of these students has a financial need to be able to cover. These students have said, I'm willing to sacrifice a week out of my summer to be able to go, to be more equipped to present the gospel. On top of that, we also have one of the reasons that we're looking to do a charter. This isn't because, hey, wouldn't it be fun to have a charter bus? For us to take all 39 of us, we're going to take both of those buses, and then we also need an additional 8-passenger vehicle to take all 39 of us. We take both of those church buses. There's no longer a church bus ministry that's able to happen for the 2 Sundays that we would need it to travel. On top of that, for us taking a charter bus, that gives me as the youth pastor, along with the other adult leaders that are going to be going with us, 17 hours one way, so that's 34 hours of discipleship and hanging out with these students to be able to just pour into them. Those are the needs that we have, these students personally, and then also, hey, we have the transportation, but wouldn't it be even better on both ends for the church to be able to continue the bus ministry that we do on Sunday mornings and throughout the week, and as well for us leaders to be able to pour into these students for 34 hours. That's all I have. Thank you.
So talk to Pastor Drew after we have already taken the offering. This is up to you to talk to Pastor Drew. Now I'd like to call Jim Mayo to come forward. Jim and Sue, are you coming up too, Sue? Great. Jim and Sue Mayo to come up, and they have one more presentation about an opportunity that we have to participate with Compassion International in helping to sponsor children. You want the video first? Okay, go ahead.
A child is waiting.
A child is waiting.
There are children around the world waiting.
Children are waiting.
I live here with my family, my mom and dad, and all my brothers. I am the only daughter. Our home is built over a very dirty river. And when the storms happen, our home floods with water and garbage. This is a scary place when it gets dark. People get drunk and fight all the time. I do not go outside at night because I don't know what would happen. Even though I live in this place, I have been sponsored for 14 years by Arlie and Nancy. I call them Mom and Dad. Although we are countries apart, I know they chose me. They tell me, Eunice, we remember you. We love you. You are like our own daughter. Because of my sponsors, I had the opportunity to go to the Compassion program at the church in my neighborhood. For all these years, my sponsors and my church have helped me to receive better food and medicine. With the help of my sponsors, I will be able to work to help my own family. When I was 9, my compassion teacher shared Jesus with us, and that's when I accepted Christ. Even though I am poor, He has provided my church. He gave me sponsors who love me. God will never leave us. I want to share everything I have learned with kids who are like me, other children who need sponsors because they also experience poverty. I want them to feel the joy of having a sponsor, to get a letter that says, "I love you. You are special to me." With the help of our sponsors, we can grow up and finish our studies and learn how to live our faith in Jesus. I want to serve the Lord, and I won't stop serving Him because He does not stop loving me and taking care of me and my family.
There are children around the world waiting. Waiting for a sponsor like you.
Like you.
Release a child from poverty in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name. A child is waiting for you.
We're Sue and Jim Mayo, and we've been ministry partners here for about 12 years, and it was at about the same time that we became ministry partners here at Calvary that we had the privilege of viewing a video very similar to what you just have seen. While we were sitting there watching that video, the Holy Spirit was moving in our hearts, just as He may have been and is likely moving in some of your hearts right this moment. At the conclusion of that service, we went back into the foyer area and were introduced to a child. And we would be privileged to be able to introduce you to a child today that you could support. So Sue's going to talk a little bit about the experience that we've had with Compassion International.
You see up on the screen our two daughters. Chorpaga Suwanachet is our first one, and we were given her right away. She graduated, though, from the program. Once your village attains a certain level, then the village graduates. And so at that point, we were given our porn. And our porn is now 13 years old. It's my job to write to our porn. And up until about, probably 6 months ago, I was only writing to her when she wrote to us, which is like three times a year. And then I saw a video clip on the Compassion website and realized that our porn was waiting for our letters and that it was really meaningful to her to get a letter. Imagine if you were a child and you didn't get a letter and everybody else did. And if you've ever had that experience, you know exactly what that's like. And so I decided that our porn needed more letters. And so I promptly wrote a card and a letter and another letter. Our porn asked just recently what verses we memorized. And so I was able to give her a couple. And then in the last letter I gave her, the latest one was, "Rejoice in the Lord always." Now, I'd already memorized that. That wasn't a hard thing. But it came out of a Bible study that I was doing. And I thought, she needs to know this one. And she needs to be able to memorize it. We are our porn's only sponsor. We don't share her with anybody else. So if I don't write to her, nobody does. We are the ones who contribute the money each month to pay for her needs. And we're happy to do it. Our porn appreciates it. I know that when Chorpaga graduated, she wrote us a letter of thanks for supporting her for the years that we did. But it doesn't stop there. I became convicted also this last year of the need to do a little bit more. And so I decided that our grandchildren needed to learn how to give. And so we looked for ways that they could help. So they came and they bagged food for the refugees. And on Thanksgiving Day, two of them delivered meals. And then at Christmas time, they each lost a present. And the present instead went to Compassion. And we bought two flocks of chickens. And they were donated in our grandchildren's names. Then there was a dartball tournament here. And I said, when nobody else was willing to do it, I said, yeah, I'll take care of the concessions. And so with the help of my daughter and grandchildren and Sue Moss, we managed to raise $378, enough for 9 flocks of chickens to be sent to people in needy countries.
Psalms 82:3 says this, defend the cause of the weak and the fatherless, maintain the rights of the poor and the oppressed, rescue the weak and the needy. If the Holy Spirit has been speaking to you, Sue and I will be at a table out there. We'd love to introduce you to one of the 19 children that we have been assigned here. 2 Peter 3:18, and this is to you as believers, but grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Let's all stand together and let's sing this chorus out. Oh, praise the one.
Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised his life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised his life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised his life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised his life up from the dead.
Jesus, you paid my debt. Oh, yeah, Jesus. Jesus paid it all.
Jesus paid it all.
Sin had left a crimson stain.
Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Let's give a shout of praise, church. Come on. He washed it white as snow. Amen. Thank you, Father. Thank you so much for paying it all for us. We give you praise, Lord. We love you. We thank you. Amen. You are dismissed.
Oh, praise the one.